Hello everyone, I am Dr. Vaishnavi. I am an ENT surgeon and ENT faculty for the postgraduates at various platforms. And today I am here to discuss about the middle ear spaces and especially the epitympanic space or the epitympanic recess. This is designed for students who are already in your ENT or who are studying ENT already, and they have finished their postgraduate entrance exam and they have reached to this level that they are studying ENT at the moment. So there were a few people who felt that this topic is a little difficult to understand, and they requested me to do this video, for which I am doing this, and I hope it will be helpful for us as well. So we start with the class. So basically in the middle ear, so we have our external auditory canal, which leads to your middle ear, and that further leads to your inner ear. So this middle ear has to have air in it so that it can conduct sounds very well from your external auditory canal to your inner ear. So if this middle ear has to have air within it, how is it getting ventilated? So there are three distinct pathways of ventilation. One comes from the epitympanic part, one is in the promontory part, and one is in the hypotympanic part. And each of these pathways will collapse at the tympanic orifice of the Eustachian tube, which is present in the anterior wall of the middle ear. So with this brief introduction, I will be discussing mainly about the epitympanic space or the epitympanic recess. Now in the epitympanum or your posterior mesotympanum or your hypotympanum, basically in the middle ear, we have got mucosal folds. Why do we have mucosal folds? Because we have tendons, we have muscles. So to cover those tendons, to cover the ossicles, to cover the muscles, we have got mucosa, which form a fold over these muscles, over these tendons, and over the ligament, and they carry blood supply to the ossicles, to the muscles, and to the tendon or the ligament of which are present in your middle ear, which is your tensor tympani and your stapedius. So when these mucosal folds cover the contents of your middle ear, they form separate folds that will divide the middle ear space into compartments. So we are trying to understand the anatomy of this compartment so that we know how the disease pathology occurs and how we have to clear the disease at the time of surgery. So the only route for ventilation to the epitympanum from the mesotympanum is via two small openings in the mucosal fold. So if I take this as your middle ear, we know in the middle ear there is an epitympanum, which is also called as your attic. Then we have got mesotympanum, which is your middle part across the pars tensa. And you have the hypotympanum, which is the part of the middle ear below the level of the annulus. Now we know in the anterior wall we have the Eustachian tubal orifice. Through the Eustachian tubal orifice, we have the air entering into the middle ear. Now from the middle ear, if it has to go, the air has to go into the epitympanum, it cannot go directly because there is a diaphragm. There's a diaphragm. This diaphragm separates the epitympanum and the mesotympanum. This mesotympanum and hypotympanum get a direct air current from the Eustachian tube, whereas the epitympanum, it has to go through two small openings. One is an anterior opening and the second one is a posterior opening. The small openings are called as isthmus. So you have an anterior isthmus tympani and you have a posterior isthmus tympani. Okay, so you have got two isthmus, an anterior isthmus tympani and a posterior isthmus tympani, which will provide a route for ventilation from your mesotympanum to your epitympanum. And from the Eustachian tube, it cannot go directly, but it has to go through these two communications, which communicate your mesotympanum with the epitympanum. Now, what is anterior tympanic isthmus and what is your posterior tympanic isthmus? So, anterior tympanic isthmus is present between your tensor tympani and the crura of the stapes. So, where is this anterior isthmus present? So, you can see here, this is your crura of the stapes. We know the tensor tympani attaches to the neck of the malleus. So this is an axial view of the epitympanum. So you can see this is your malleus, this is your incus. So to the neck of the malleus, we have got the tensor tympanic tendon, which takes a turn around the cochleariform process to get inserted into the neck of malleus. So this space, which is present between the tensor tympani tendon and the crura of the stapes, this space is called as anterior tympanic isthmus. Now, what is posterior tympanic isthmus? So, posterior tympanic isthmus is this space. Now, what is this space bounded by? This is your short process of incus. To the short process of incus, behind that you have got a fold which is called as the posterior incudal ligament. So this is your anterior, this is your posterior. So here you have the posterior incudal ligament. From the pyramid, you have got the stapedius muscle originating. So you have the pyramid here, and from the pyramid goes your stapedius muscle to the neck of stapes. From the incus, you have got a medial incudal fold and a lateral incudal fold. So this entire space between the medial incudal fold, stapedius muscle, pyramidal eminence, short process of the incus, and the posterior incudal ligament, this entire space is your posterior tympanic isthmus. So I will repeat this again. We have two spaces or communications which will communicate your epitympanum to your mesotympanum. One is an anterior tympanic isthmus. The second one is your posterior tympanic isthmus. The anterior tympanic isthmus lies between the tensor tympani tendon and the crura of the stapes. The posterior tympanic isthmus lies between the pyramidal eminence, from which comes the stapedius muscle, and then you have got the medial incudal fold. From the medial incudal fold towards the short process of the incus and the posterior incudal ligament, this entire space which is bounded by these vital structure is your posterior tympanic isthmus. So from the mesotympanum, the air reaches the epitympanum through these spaces. So if there is a blockage at this level or at this level, the ventilation to the epitympanum gets affected, resulting in cholesteatoma or a retraction pocket, and that will occur likewise. Now, one space that is very, very important for us is your Prusak space. Now, what is Prusak space? This Prusak space is bounded by pars flaccida. So you can see this is your pars flaccida. This is your neck of malleus, and superiorly you have got the lateral malleolar fold. So this space, which is bounded by the neck of malleus, lateral malleolar fold, and the pars flaccida, this entire space is called as your Prusak space. This is the space where the cholesteatoma or the retraction pocket begins initially. From there, it goes into the anterior epitympanic space, and from there into the posterior epitympanic space, and from there into your mastoid air cell system. Okay, so this space is of utmost importance to us. So I hope you understood what is anterior tympanic isthmus, posterior tympanic isthmus, and your Prusak space. Now, what is epitympanic diaphragm? So I have told you very clearly that there is a diaphragm or a partition which separates your epitympanic space from your mesotympanic space. So this is called diaphragm. So this diaphragm has to have certain boundary. What is it formed by? What is this diaphragm formed by? So this diaphragm is formed by three malleal folds. Here you have the anterior malleolar fold. Similarly, behind that you will have your posterior malleolar fold. And then you have the lateral malleolar folds. So these three folds together, along with the posterior incudal ligament. This is your posterior incudal ligament. Along with these two folds, one is your tensor fold and your lateral incudomalleal fold. This together will form your epitympanic diaphragm, below which is your mesotympanum and above which is your epitympanum. Now, we have to divide this epitympanic space into two compartments, an anterior compartment, an anterior epitympanic space, and the posterior epitympanic space. Now, before we divide it into anterior and posterior epitympanic space, let's see again about the epitympanic diaphragm, because this is very important. Any variations in this epitympanic diaphragm will change the ventilation to your epitympanum, resulting in a retraction pocket, resulting in cholestatoma. So what does it extend from? The epitympanic diaphragm extends anteriorly from your tensor fold. So you can see here, this is your tensor fold anteriorly. Posteriorly, it extends up to the pyramidal eminence or your pyramidal process posteriorly and inferiorly. And superiorly, it extends up to your posterior includal ligament. So this is your posterior includal ligament. This is your posterosuperior limit. So this entire diaphragm, this entire thing is your diaphragm. So it is formed by your tensor fold anteriorly, and then it extends posteriorly till the pyramidal eminence and to the posterior incudal ligament posteriorly. So you see this tract that is present here, these gaps that are present here. Through these gaps, the epitympanum gets ventilated. You have an anterior tract and a posterior tract, and through this epitympanic diaphragm also, you will have small ventilatory pathways that will communicate your mesotympanum to your epitympanum. So I hope you understood about what is an epitympanic diaphragm. So if this is a very important thing, if there is a problem in your epitympanic diaphragm, the ventilation to your epitympanum gets affected to a gross extent. So it is formed anteriorly by the tensor fold. This is a sagittal view. This is an axial view. So you can see it is going from your tensor fold anteriorly to your pyramidal eminence postero inferiorly and to your posterior incudal ligament postero superiorly. Okay, so this is about the epitympanic diaphragm. Now we have got cog. Cog is a vertical crest of bone that comes from the tegmen, and it is dividing your epitympanic space into your anterior epitympanic space and your posterior epitympanic space. So we know what is there in the floor of the epitympanum already. We know this diaphragm is made up of the tensor fold. It goes posteriorly till the pyramidal eminence and the posterior incudal ligament. So we know what is there inferiorly. Now, how is this space divided? This space is divided into an anterior compartment and a posterior compartment. Anterior compartment is called as anterior epitympanic space. Posterior compartment is called as posterior epitympanic space. Now, this posterior epitympanic space is further subdivided into two compartments. How is this posterior epitympanic space subdivided? It is divided into a medial compartment and a lateral compartment. This lateral compartment is very narrow, and this lateral compartment is further divided into a superior lateral compartment and the inferior lateral compartment. What is dividing it into superior and inferior? This fold, the purple color structure that you see here, this fold is called as the lateral incudomalleal fold. So the lateral incudomalleal fold will divide it into a superior compartment and below that into an inferior compartment. So we have the epitympanum. We know what is the floor or the diaphragm. It separates the epitympanum from mesotympanum. We know the cog divides it into an anterior epitympanic space and the posterior epitympanic space. And the posterior epitympanic space is further divided into medial and lateral space. Lateral space is further divided to superior and inferior by the lateral incudomalleal fold. I hope this anatomy is clear so far. Now the ventilation pathway to the epitympanum can be through two pathways. One is anterior pathway and the second one is your posterior pathway. So you can see here the red arrow indicates your anterior pathway, which I have told you goes through the anterior tympanic isthmus. Anterior tympanic isthmus is present between your tensor tympani tendon. You can see here the tensor tympani attaching to your neck of the stapes, and a neck of the malleus, and this is your crura of the stapes. So this is your anterior pathway. So through your anterior pathway goes one of the airflow. The second one is your posterior pathway, through which it goes to the posterior tympanic isthmus. So this is the two ventilatory pathways. Additionally, through the diaphragm, there are small minor areas through which the tympanic epitympanic cavity can get ventilated. Now, there can be anatomical variations in this epitympanic cavity by these folds. The main very important thing that will cause a variation is your tensor fold. So this is your tensor fold. You can see this tensor fold can be horizontally attached or it can be vertically attached. You can make out when the tensor fold is horizontal, what is happening to the recess? You are having a narrow supratubal recess. But when the tensor fold is vertical, the supratubal recess becomes wider. Okay, so you can see the supratubal recess. This is your supratubal recess. If it is horizontally attached, you do not have or no space. It is absent or it is very small. Whereas if it is vertically attached, you can see a nice space over here. This is your supratubal recess, which is giving a good amount of space for air to go in into the posterior epitympanum. Anterior epitympanum. So your tensor fold will determine how is the ventilation. So this is your anterior epitympanic space. This is your tensor fold. If it is horizontally attached, you don't see any space above the Eustachian tube. So it is absent. But if there is a vertically attached tensor fold, you see a good pneumatized supratubal recess. Then there can be blockages to the epitympanic pathway. Now, what will happen if the blockage of the isthmus is associated with a complete tensor fold? So, if you see here, if the tensor fold or the diaphragmatic fold is complete, there is no pathway for the air to go from the Eustachian tube. It stays in the mesotympanum only and it cannot go into the epitympanum. So, if the epitympanum is not ventilated, what will happen? There will be a retraction pocket, which is isolated only to the epitympanum or the attic. So there is a retraction pocket in the attic or the epitympanum. Okay, without any pathological tissue in the epitympanic space. So when you have a complete tensor fold, this is your tensor fold. If this is complete and you do not have minor pathways, usually this is incomplete. The tensor fold is not completely present, it is incomplete and it has minor holes for ventilation from the mesotympanum to your epitympanum. But if it is completely present, it obscures or it inhibits the ventilation from the mesotympanum into your epitympanum. Now, if the blockage of the isthmus is associated with a vertically attached tensor fold, you can see here the tensor fold could be incomplete or it could be vertically attached, and there is an area for ventilation from the mesotympanum into the epitympanum. But since it is vertically attached, there is a small area posteriorly. We know this is anterior because the Eustachian tube opens anteriorly. So you see a small posterior retraction pocket. Okay, so a small posterior retraction pocket should make you or enable you to think that probably this tensor fold is vertically attached or it is an incomplete, not a complete one, meaning it has a hole through which the air can enter from the mesotympanum to the epitympanum. And the third one could be a complete epidermization of the attic space. When there is a complete blockage of the isthmus and complete blockage of the antrum. Okay, you have the antrum behind. So if you have the complete blockage of the antrum, additus, attic, and there is no ventilation from the mesotympanum to the epitympanum because of a complete tensor fold, and there is complete keratinization or epidermization of the epitympanum, then there will be called as type C or type C type of disease. Okay, so what is selective? So we'll see what is selective epitympanic dysventilation syndrome. Normally, if the epitympanum or the mesotympanum is not getting ventilated, we always think that there is a eustachian tubal pathology. So a eustachian tubal pathology is resulting in a middle ear disease is what we always think of. But there can be situations where an isthmus blockage is occurring because of a complete tensor fold or a complete incudomalular fold resulting in non-ventilation. So if there is a complete tensor fold like this, even if a eustachian tube is functioning well, even if the eustachian tube is patent, can it ventilate the epitympanum from the mesotympanum? Obviously not. So in such situations, we call it as selective epitympanic dysventilation syndrome. So here there are four conditions. One, there should be a selective attic retraction pocket, or there should be only a attic cholestatoma. In the mesotympanum, you should not have a cholestatoma. You should do a tympanogram which will show a type A tympanogram, or the eustachian tubal function test should be normal, which means that the problem or pathology is not in the eustachian tube, but it is because of the fold or the tensor fold, which is complete, not allowing the ventilation to occur from the mesotympanum into your epitympanum. There should be a complete diaphragm, meaning the diaphragm is complete without any holes or aperture or isthmus block. So there is complete block resulting in non-ventilation from the mesotympanum to the epitympanum, and there must be an isthmus blockage. Then we call it as selective epitympanic dysventilation syndrome. So you can see here, this there is a type of disease that is obscuring your complete diaphragm. You see that there is a complete tensor fold. There is a disease here, and this is your geniculate ganglion, or the horizontal part of the facial nerve from the geniculate ganglion. So you see that the tensor fold is complete. There is a disease present between the malleus and the incus, and then over the geniculate ganglion and the horizontal part of the stapes. So if there is a blockage here because of a mucosal fold or because of granulation, then we call it as selective epitympanic dysventilation syndrome. So what is the criteria? One, there should be a complete diaphragm, meaning there should be no holes. Second, there should be a complete diaphragm. Second thing here is the tensor fold should be complete. So the tensor fold is complete. The eustachian tube is patent. And how do we know eustachian tube is patent? By doing a tympanometry and by doing eustachian tubal test. And on examination, the disease should be present only in the attic, which is evidenced by only a selective attic retraction pocket or only a attic cholestatoma. So selective epitympanic dysventilation syndrome occurs whenever there is an isthmus block, complete diaphragm, when there is normal eustachian tube, and you see selective attic retraction and a attic cholestatoma. Now, how do this cholestatoma spread? If there is a cholestatoma, we need to know the pathways of spread of cholestatoma. So there are various pathways for the spread of cholestatoma. We all know that initially it begins in the Prusak space. From the Prusak space, it can go into the superior intercostal space. From the superior intercostal space, it can go into the adipose and into the adipose. So, okay, it can go from the Prusak space into the mesotympanum, and from there into the retrotympanic spaces through the facial recess and the sinus tympani, which is your retrotympanic space. From there, again, it can reach into your mastoid air cell system. The cholestatoma can be also present in the anterior epitympanic space. And when it is present in the anterior epitympanic space, it is in close proximity to the geniculate ganglion and to the horizontal segment of the facial nerve. So an anterior epitympanic cholestatoma has a great proximity to the geniculate ganglion and to the horizontal segment of the facial nerve. So this is how the cholestatoma can spread from the Prusak space to the superior intercostal space, and from there into the mastoid It can go through the facial recess and sinus tympani, through the retrotympanic space, and from there again into the mastoid. Anterior epitympanic space cholesteatoma is present in the anterior epitympanum, and here you will have it in very close proximity to the geniculate ganglion. Now we have endoscopic approaches or endoscopic surgeries, type 1, type 2, and type 3. So in type 1 endoscopic tympanoplasty, you have a blockage at the isthmus, but the ossicular chain is normal. So what do we do here? We carefully dissect out the disease from the incudostapedial joint and the cochleariform process without disrupting the ossicular chain. And when the tensor fold is complete, meaning there is no hole in the tensor fold, we remove the tensor fold or make a communication through the tensor fold from the to the epitympanum from the mesotympanum. So from the mesotympanum, where the eustachian tube opens, we try to make a communication by removing the tensor fold completely or making a aperture through the tensor fold. So here we are trying to preserve the ossicle, and we are making a communication between the meso and epitympanum by removing the tensor fold or making a defect in the tensor fold. Type 2 tympanoplasty. Here in type 1, the ossicular chain is normal. In type 2, what do we do? What do we see? If there is erosion of the ossicular chain. So when there is erosion of the ossicular chain, we see that the incus is present with disruption of the incudostapedial joint. And associated with it, if there is a blockage of the tympanic isthmus, then we do this endoscopic type 2 tympanoplasty. So what do we do in this endoscopic type 2 tympanoplasty? We make an aperture in the tensor fold, and we make a low tympanoplasty. We do not make any ossicular connections in the epitympanum, but instead we make ossicular connection between the stapes and the incus by doing a low tympanoplasty, that ventilation to the epitympanum is unaffected. Okay, so this is called as type 2 endoscopic tympanoplasty. Here we just remove the head of malleus so that the epitympanum is a wide space, giving good ventilation to the epitympanum. Okay. So let's see what is type 3 endoscopic tympanoplasty. So what is endoscopic type 3 tympanoplasty? In endoscopic type 3, or when we have seen that there is complete epidermization of the attic and the antrum, and the antrum is blocked, the attic is blocked, the epitympan is blocked, and it is not possible to restore a good ventilation pathway to these patients, then we do a technique which is called as an endoscopic open technique. So in this endoscopic open technique, after with the help of an endoscope, with the transcanal approach, we go and approach the middle ear. We elevate the tympanometal flap, identify the disease, we try to approach the attic or epitympanum by drilling the scutum or removing the scutum, and we try to completely remove the disease from the attic and try to communicate the antrum and the additus to the middle ear, and also reconstruct the middle ear at a later date, and we use a temporalis fascia graft to keep the middle ear or the mesotympanum away from the epitympanum, additus, and the antrum. So we do not try to communicate them directly, but we put a temporalis fascia in between. This is a little complex procedure and takes a little time to describe elaborately, but just in brief, this is the principle of that procedure. So I hope you've understood what is an epitympanic space or an epitympanic recess. If you have any doubt, you can always feel free to ask me, and I can always make videos for you if you have any topic that seems difficult to you. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.